Welcome to the next installment of our PLL training. One of the great reasons to have an integrated synthesizer is that you can change the frequencies on the fly to get different output frequencies. In previous Precision Labs modules, we have discussed the key parameters and the building blocks of the PLL. Now let's dive deeper into how PLLs behave and what we can predict about their transient response and lock time. Here's a quick review of the PLL blocks. The reference oscillator frequency, FOS, is divided down by the R divider to create the phase detector frequency, FPD. The VCO frequency, FVCO, is divided down by the N divider to create the feedback signal to the phase detector, F sub N. The loop filter integrates these charges from the current source and sink and produces a tuning voltage to steer the VCO output frequency. The PLL is a negative feedback control system whose inputs FPD and FN produce an intermediate voltage output that drives the VCO to produce the final output frequency, FVCO. The FVCO may be further divided by an output divider to produce FOUT. Now, if you need a refresher on PLL building blocks, take a look at the previous TI Precision Labs that describe them. In the TI Precision Labs video on the PLL phase noise figure of merit, we talked about the phase noise characteristics of each of the blocks in the PLL and what the transfer functions look like. From the table, it is important to note that all the blocks except for the VCO are multiplied by the low-pass transfer function G over 1 plus GH, while the VCO is multiplied by the high-pass transfer function 1 over 1 plus GH. Loop bandwidth, BW, is the most critical loop filter parameter affecting the transient response and is defined as a frequency that makes the magnitude of G times H equals to 1. Here you can see the transient response of a PLL that demonstrates the settling time of the VCO tuning voltage. The total time taken to change the VCO frequency is completely associated with the analog lock time in this case. When VCO integrated RF synthesizers were first introduced, the VCO had multiple frequency bands, but the coverage was limited because there is only a single VCO core inductor. As a consequence of not having a single VCO core, multiple devices were often required to support different applications. Today's modern RF synthesizers typically add multiple cores to the VCO along with output dividers to enable a single device to support a very broad frequency range with no gaps in frequency coverage. VCO calibration is required to select the correct VCO core and calibration settings associated with the target frequency. Additionally, it brings the VCO frequency much closer to the target frequency, therefore reducing the analog lock time. The calibration routine changes the transient response of the PLL by both adding the VCO calibration time and also impacting the analog lock time. The total time taken by most modern multi-core RF synthesizers to switch between frequencies depends upon two factors, the VCO calibration time and the analog lock time. Let's zoom in to the region where the analog lock time starts after the VCO calibration is complete. The transient response in this region behaves in a similar way compared to the analog loop filter transient. As the frequency is decreasing here, the shape of the response is inverted. For the rest of this video, we'll focus on the analog lock time portion of the transient response and refer to it as a lock time for simplicity. Lock time is the time it takes for the PLL to change from one frequency to another and stay within a predefined tolerance. The tolerance depends upon a few things: the magnitude of the frequency jump between the initial and final frequency, the tolerance within which the PLL is considered to be locked. Lock time increases as a slow logarithmic ratio of frequency jump to tolerance. The higher the tolerance, the faster the PLL will be considered to be locked. In a similar way, the larger the change in frequency, the longer it will take for the output to be considered to be locked. Finally, the loop bandwidth of the PLL and the phase margin greatly impact the lock time as well. We will discuss these further in the rest of the video. In the transient response pictured here, after the VCO reaches the initial peak frequency, the negative feedback overcompensates, causing a ringing effect to the output frequency. The PLL is considered to be locked when this ringing settles within the predefined tolerance. Whether the VCO frequency rings or simply rises and falls to the target frequency depends upon the characteristics of the loop filter. The output of the charge pump passes through the loop filter. The low-pass filter accumulates the correction pulses from the charge pump and converts them into voltage, the VCO tuning voltage, which here we call VTune. The graph of the VCO tuning voltage and VCO output frequency are plotted against time. The VCO frequency tracks the changes in tuning voltage. The VCO gain, also known as KVCO, quantifies the change to the output frequency based on the tuning voltage. VCO gain is typically given in units of megahertz per volt. In this region, the charge pump is continuously sourcing current pulses to increase the VCO tuning voltage. The tuning voltage may cross the target frequency before the phase detector and charge pump react to slow down the increase in frequency. Next, the negative feedback of the PLL starts to kick in and the charge pump duty cycle drops and finally starts sinking the current to drive the VCO tuning voltage in the opposite direction. This is where the VCO frequency peaks. Finally, the loop continues to compensate for the higher VCO frequency. The charge pump will provide sinking current pulses, causing the VCO tuning voltage and consequently the VCO frequency to drop to the intended output frequency and settle. The magnitude of the overshoot in frequency and whether is significant or not to say exists depends upon the loop filter dynamics. In this graph, we see the effect of changing the loop bandwidth on the transient response of the PLL and more specifically on the lock time. As the bandwidth decreases from 60 kHz to 40 kHz and then to 20 kHz, you can see the time it takes the PLL to settle at the target frequency increase. Lock time is inversely proportional to loop bandwidth and can be estimated as 4 divided by loop bandwidth. For example, if the loop bandwidth is 1 kHz, then the lock time is approximately equal to 4 milliseconds. Lock time can be fast or slow depending upon the PLL loop bandwidth. In general, a wider loop bandwidth reduces the lock time, while a narrow loop bandwidth increases the lock time. Phase margin relates to the stability of the PLL. Pictured here is the Bode plot of the open loop transfer function of the PLL. The phase margin tells us how far away from the minus 180 degree phase we are, where the gain is 0 dB. It can also be calculated as 180 degrees plus the phase of the open loop transfer function at the loop bandwidth frequency offset. Keep in mind the phase of the open loop transfer function is a negative number in the range of minus 90 to minus 180 degrees. Let's take a look at the effects of changing the phase margin on the analog lock time. Like the loop bandwidth of the PLL, phase margin is also dependent on the characteristics of the PLL transfer function. When the phase margin goes much below 30 degrees, you risk having an unstable PLL and produce lots of ringing in the transient response. The picture graph has a simulation of one of TI's high-performance PLL synthesizers' transient response when changing the frequency from 6 GHz to 7 GHz with 30 degrees phase margin. The loop bandwidth is kept constant at 100 kHz in the following simulations. Although the phase margin is in the 30 to 45 degree range, may produce some ringing, this might help in reducing the spurs. As we increase the phase margin further to 50 degrees, the ringing decreases as well as the analog lock time. Note how the VCO frequency stabilizes to the target 7 GHz much faster than the previous simulation. Good general purpose choice of phase margin to balance lock time, phase margin, and spur occur in the 45 to 55 degree range. A 48 degree phase margin is a good choice for optimal lock time. Higher phase margins, up to about 80 degrees, are good for a flat loop filter response, which is a desirable response for reducing jitter. Now that we have talked about different factors that affect the lock time of the PLL, wouldn't it be great to have a way to simulate the performance of actual devices? For this reason, we have TI's PLLatinum Sim. Let's quickly step through how you can set up the transient response simulations. After selecting the TI device you want to model, you can access the feature by clicking the Lock Time tab. The top left screen depicts your PLL setup. You can edit the dividers and frequencies here to map to your application. The bottom section contains two graphs. The graph on the left plots the VCO frequency over time, which settles to the final frequency targeted. The graph on the right plots the change in phase error over time, which settles to zero. The start and final frequencies, as well as the tolerance for settling, can be entered in here. And finally, the simulated lock time is displayed. There is an option to exclude or include the VCO calibration. You'll want to include the VCO calibration in the case you are using a multi-core VCO. For more information on what influences VCO calibration process, please refer to our application note in this topic entitled Streamline RF Synthesizer VCO Calibration and Optimize PLL Lock Time. Thanks for watching this video on PLL Transient Response. Please take a few minutes to test your understanding of concepts presented in this video by taking our short quiz. If you need more information on clocks and timing, visit ti.com/clocks.